Good evening, everybody. I'm Stesha Brandon, the Literature and Humanities Program Manager here at the Seattle Public Library. And as we begin this evening, I would like to acknowledge that we are on Indigenous land. Here in Seattle, these are the traditional unceded territories of the Coast Salish people, specifically the Duwamish people. We honor their elders past and present, and we thank them for their stewardship of this land. Welcome to tonight's program with Jenny Liou and Shin Yu Pai, presented in partnership with Open Books. We're grateful to our series sponsor, the Gary and Connie Kunis Foundation, and to the Seattle Times for their generous support of library programs. Thanks as well to the Seattle Public Library Foundation. Private gifts to the foundation from thousands of donors help the library provide free programs and services that touch the lives of everyone in our community. I'd like to give a big hello and welcome to all of our attendees here at Central Library and also watching the live stream. I have just a few announcements before we get started. If you're here with us in person tonight, Open Books have copies of Jenny's book at their table to your right. And if you're watching online, you will be able to find Jenny's books at Open Books website. And I'm gonna pop a link to the chat so you can just go directly to their site to get the book. And then for folks here in person, as I mentioned earlier, if you need to exit the auditorium during the event, there is a door to your right. You may have noticed that the building is officially closed, but the restrooms will be open for the duration of the program. After tonight's presentation and then conversation, there will be time for questions from the audience. For folks here in person, you can write your questions on the little cards that I passed out as you came in. And if you're watching online, you can ask your question at any time by writing it in the Q&A box that's at the bottom of your screen. And then finally, we are interested in hearing from you. So toward the close of the event, we'll post a link to a survey in the chat for the online audience, and we'll collect paper surveys here as folks are leaving the in-person event. I would appreciate it if you took a minute to fill it out. I was telling somebody before the program started that I really do read every single survey, and we use the feedback that you give us to help shape the programming here at the library. Now it is my pleasure to welcome Shin Yu Pai, the library's public engagement guest curator, who's put together some wonderful programs for the library this fall and culminating in tonight's event. Shin Yu is the former program director of Town Hall Seattle and curated and produced events for Atlas Obscura while leading public programs for Atlas Obscura Society in Seattle for 5 years. She's the author of 11 books of poetry and a 2022 Artist Trust Fellow. She's the host and creator of The Blue Suit, a podcast on Asian American stories produced by KUOW Public Radio, Seattle's NPR affiliate. Here to introduce tonight's speaker, please help me welcome Shin Yu Pai.
Thank you so much to Stesha and Seattle Public Library for hosting these events. It's been a real pleasure these last few months to curate for the library. When Kaya Press, a publisher of Asian Pacific diasporic literature based out of Los Angeles, sent me the press kit for Jenny Liou's Muscle Memory, her new book, I was deeply intrigued. Writers are notorious for living from the neck up, writing from the mind instead of the body or an embodied experience. Jenny's poems take on the subject of violence and physicality to explore the body's knowledge and how trauma can also serve as a marker of identity. What might competitive sports and poetry writing have in common? And how might we understand a connection between blood sport and intergenerational and immigrant traumas? Tonight, we'll explore these questions with Jenny Liou, a mixed race Asian American writer who has defied cultural and gender expectations to rise to the top of more than one discipline. Jenny Liou is an English professor at Pierce College in Puyallup, where she teaches composition, literature, and creative writing. As a Northwest Climate Adaptation Science Fellow at the University of Washington, her research focused on eco-cultural restoration, environmental research co-produced with Indigenous partners, and ecological restoration strategies durable to climate change. Jenny received her PhD in British literature and an MFA in poetry from the University of California at Irvine. Her books include Muscle Memory, a collection of poems from which we'll hear her read tonight, and an earlier collection, Vesuvius at Home, from Finishing Line Press. In addition to her work as a writer and scholar, Jenny is a retired professional mixed martial arts cage fighter who fought competitively from 2011 to 2017. Originally from Moscow, Idaho, Jenny currently lives and writes in Covington, Washington. Please welcome Jenny Liou.
Thank you all. That was just happy laughter. I've just come to so many events here that it's sort of unbelievable and exciting to be up here in front of all of you. Yeah, it doesn't quite seem real yet. So is the volume appropriate? This is good. All right. So I'm just going to, I think, start reading at the beginning and give you a sort of the skeleton of the book, moving through sequentially. And I can't help but talk about all of them along the way. So we'll start with a poem called Scansion Between the Ropes. Here is the myth of poetry, of what it has lost and is forever trying to recover. Poetry was feet on a road, breath nudging lungs, hands on a foe or beloved. And then we wrote it down and printed it, wrung the life out of it, threw away the flesh. But for five rounds, none of that was true. The jab cross is the boxer's ion, the jab jab cross, her anapest. So there's kind of a few strands braided together in this book. There's the poems about fighting, and then there's the poems about my family's stories. And I was kind of surprised to find them entangling as I wrote the book. So I'm gonna read a poem from that other strand now, and hopefully we'll begin to see how they braid. This is called Our Bones. My father picks his mother's skull out of ashes, and we sort through the lesser bones while he writes on our urn. He's practiced weeks for this, hiding a fever, hiding a shaky hand. He wants us to mark this moment well. We're here to learn about our family, how the rice fields that were his are no one's now, the brothers he once had marked with forgotten stones. I saw the great fires. I saw the sweat on his brow as he hefted her into the oven, then shut the door. Is this the closest we can come to love? Even the earth has no room for us, so we make each other small. One of the odd things about reading here tonight, odd and lovely and nerve-wracking things about reading here tonight, is that I begged my parents to Zoom into this. And I think this is the first time that they've heard a lot of these poems. So it's unexpectedly moving for me to, and terrifying for me to speak these poems aloud, talking about my family in this way while they're listening. Here's another about my family, slouching toward. My grandfather's children found his military flight log after he died. No one seemed to want it, so I asked. An uncle said I wouldn't understand. I said my dad could translate, but they said he couldn't. He's the prodigal son, so they're shutting him out too. We go to a museum to search out a more public spectacle of suffering and find jade earrings. The progress of Chinese culture can be charted by the punctures made by jewelry, which correspond to what each civilization considered healable. Each earring is much larger than anything I'd forced through any part of my body, but I guess that's the whole idea. A foreign adornment narrowed to the sharpness of a pin you let in, even as it widens into the gyre of a history that isn't yours, but consumes you. Who will heal this? The art of war. The men I fight are careful with my hair. They brush it from my eyes with clumsy hands and rearrange my ponytail, unsure if this is chivalry or rudeness. There's one who beats me every time. He's muscular, but never muscles me. Every plan becomes its opposite. He says the trick is giving anyone exactly what they want before they wish they never wanted it. He waits until I act, then uses my momentum, so the natural extension of my hope is always my surrender. I'm like, everything needs like a moment of levity, but none of these are happy poems. This is a cathartic poem. Every now and then a poem gives us an opportunity to complain. So I'm taking mine. This is called Water Cut. I got another of those losers. I'm always trying to leave a separate room, saying I always slept alone before a match. If he'd been a fighter, he wouldn't have smuggled in whiskey, then pounded on my door all night, threatening me with guns and knives and tears and listing the reasons I'd become unlovable. Winning was easy compared to all that, except maybe I broke my nose. After, I locked myself in my room, letting snot run down my face, because every fighter knows you can't blow your nose after bloodying it. When you're punch drunk, you think in little pieces with big feelings over and over. A couple days before, I'd been pinched and dizzy with a few pounds left to cut. He kept coming back, opening the sauna door to see if I was ready yet, if I'd lost enough of myself. All right, the fight poems and the family poems finally come together. This is called My Father Reads Wang Wei. I'm crashing in my parents' basement tonight because it's closer to my gym. And in the final days before my final fight, even driving home takes too much energy. My father, who at 70 is still fighting off old age with sweat and suffering, has waited up for me. He's convinced I face death in the cage to an extent that I unlikely do. Sit down, he says. He's always hated poetry, yet he wants to read his father's favorite poem to me. The wind is blowing hard against an archer's bow. It must be fall because the grass is dried out and the eagles have sharp eyes. Snow begins to drift and the horses travel quickly. He pauses and looks back. Shame. You can't look behind to see if you're nearing the ropes, so you need to know the dimensions of the ring. You also need to keep your eyes focused in the center of your opponent's chest. It's harder than it looks, not getting lost, staring into an angry heart. To practice, I run backwards through Laguna Beach, my hands in fight position. That restrictive art gets tiring, the constant readiness, the end of hoping for an end to gauging where I am by where I've been. The way I used to be. The tree line is sudden as an argument, tracing some invisible divide between enough and not enough. Here, 100 feet of brazen green, and there, bare earth, granite, alpine grasses pretending they can set root unnourished, but they do need unapparent moisture, bright light of the refracted sun, thin air, the wind, rivulets of snow melt stippling the trail. I prefer the gentle woods before this, slow climbs and the fragrant duff, the hairpinned river which, compelled to move onwards, retraces as closely as possible its old self, that cut bank point bar river refusing departure. Give me the thin line, the sliver. For some reason, there's a lot of rivers in this book too. Odd tertiary theme, I love rivers. My friend asked me to teach her daughter to kickbox. And so I drove through February snow to find a 12-year-old outside in shorts, a t-shirt, and boxing gloves. She's strong enough to hurt me if I let her. And she learns the way a child learns, her whole heart behind every punch. I start to tell her, yes, that's the cross. Imagine you're putting out a cigarette with your right foot. Then catch myself and say, imagine you're squishing a bug. Once we'd worn through snow and into soil, every kick she threw painted itself on my body in mud. I wasn't showing yet and wasn't telling yet. So I just guarded my own abdomen with extra care, glad for the fierceness of young women and for the snow which melted on her arms like accidental rivers, and for the clearing of the yard where she became a fighter and I became, well, not a mother yet, but whatever comes before that. Oh, I'm getting to the most abrupt first line in the whole book. So I kind of feel like with no further ado, here it is, shadow boxing. You know your life is fucked when you're on better terms with the person you just knocked out than you are with anyone who loves you. But that's what happened. I knocked her out, and then she hugged me, and then her father did. When I got home, I showed the video to mine. He loves Shaolin Kung Fu, believes the masters flew through groves of bamboo trees. I landed me, and then a flurry of fists. She crumples. He's disappointed. He says, maybe if I practice, I'll learn better control. He says, I should strike the air in front of her, but never her. He thinks you win by never touching anyone. And the deeper in I get, the less I disagree. When I was young, he'd grab my wrists, then teach me to break free, saying, be like water, knowing, though I didn't yet, something of evil, some premonition of the ghosts I'd have to flee. Okay, here's another family poem. It's like my parents and my husband, who's also here, and childbirth and the police and the history of my family's history in China, all wrapped up into two stanzas, hence the nervous giggle in advance. This is inheritance. We sat them on the couch, then told them, we're going to have a baby. In a family full of stories, this is another one. The premise is that my whole life, I've done everything too fast, hurting everyone. And now my reticent mother is telling my lover I was almost born in the backseat of their Monte Carlo, while my dad sped so fast the police stopped him and then, seeing what was happening, provided an escort instead of citing him. Sirens and flashing lights and blood and blood and stitches. Johnny asks how big I was, and we start discussing the birth weights of our relatives. 6 pounds, 7, 8, a family tree of tissue damage. 12, my dad announces, and my mother adds, in the middle of a war. She reminds me of how tall my father's mother was and of the pain that we passed down one generation to the next. How this is in my blood, the hunger and the loneliness my father smuggled across the plains of China in a basket and exiled in Taiwan. She points to his forehead and says the lines I'd always thought were worry lines are from the forceps grasp, that his ribs are dented too, that he was barely born. Like father, like daughter, she says, although it seems to me we're opposites, except in this. We carry our family suffering forward into the world, moving, whether we enter all at once or almost not at all, at exactly the speed of pain. There's a whole bunch of poems about my mom in this book too. I think maybe I'm just terrified of her. I found myself not reading them tonight, but as we move towards the last set of poems here, I am going to read you one of those poems. Through the first winter rain. All four tires slip sideways as the atmospheric river floods a patch of road beneath my sleeping kids. I was a child once, waking in the back seat to the headlighted funnel of a road, my mother's long scream in her choir voice, the thick thud of our minivan ramming a doe. Even as a young girl, or maybe especially so, I felt it was avoidable. I knew that in her childhood, she'd broken both her legs when her mother stopped too fast, so now she doesn't stop for anything. Swerving is what gets you killed, she says, explaining why she never tries to stop or slow or go around. I'm sure some driver's manual agrees with her, and who knows, maybe her merciless, continuous acceleration has kept us all alive. And yet, mid-slip, I gentle my hands on the wheel, forgive the asphalt's grip and my own worst reflexes. This farmer's almanac. My father gardens by instinct, which means he gardens in his good work clothes as if delivering a lecture to the earth. Maybe he's speaking the stories I've spent my entire life waiting for, unpredictable storms hovering over the Pacific. My father gardens by instinct, which means the flower beds have been replaced with vegetables that have overtaken random parts of the yard. Today, a corner of the pasture is burning. Setting fire to the past is how we feed ourselves. I couldn't decide what order the books in this, the poems in this book should go in. And someone else had to do it for me. And she did the wonderful work of putting these poems, this poem about self-forgiveness right next to the poem about fire, and then going to a poem about both of those things. Linkin Park, Early Autumn. I just reported an encampment to the county, which is unlike me, the daughter of an immigrant. It's just that a man was trying hard to set the park on fire, I tell myself, and yes, there were flames, and yes, there was smoke, but maybe my mind has shifted with this new mother's urge to keep my kids from harm. I'm reminded of my own family's fall, so sudden that my grandma, for a time, were precious gemstones while her children begged and grew up blighted. My father burns his own fields now the way he burned his mother, full of sorrow and hungry for the flames. He says he's returning minerals to the earth, as if you could return a child to his birth or a man to the illusion that he can keep his family safe. My child runs straight into the smoke, sure he is invulnerable in his brand new shoes and jacket. And I feel the green earth groaning beneath the weight of all our houses and our gleaming cars and petty little jobs. The man raises his voice, talking to his son so that mine can hear. Your turn, he says, cupping his palms around the boys, around a tiny nest of possibility. You gather pitch, you gather pine cones, strike the match. And I think this will be my last poem. It's a small poem and kind of comes full circle. This is after writing the first poem, my father couldn't stop. He told me it wasn't poetry he hated, but that I'd be a poet, which is to say, I'd spend my life with ghosts. Before his father died, he said, they'd written each other poems like stones ballasting them to earth. According to the clothbacked monk, my father says, when you plant rice, you plant one seedling, then walk backwards before planting the next. When you are looking down, you see clouds at the water's reflection. That is, when you look down at your feet, you see sky. Thank you.
Is the volume on? Yes, it is. So if any of you do have questions for Jenny, please write them down on the index cards that were passed out to you. And Stesha will come around and collect them in a little bit. And we're also taking questions in the chat for the live stream. So feel free to drop them in the chat and we'll get to them shortly. Thank you for that wonderful reading and for sharing your work with us. So for those of us in the audience who may be less familiar with MMA as a sport, can you talk a little bit about what that sport is and what attracts people to MMA versus a more traditional martial art?
Oh, sure. Yeah, I was actually having a cage fighting flashback when they closed the giant door over there. I thought my last cage fight was the last time. That I'd feel like I was walking into a space and a door was being locked behind me. So mixed martial arts, I guess, would be, you know, the sport has kind of had a history of no holds barred fighting that over the past couple of decades has been increasingly refined into a sport. So now it's kind of a combination of wrestling and jiu-jitsu and boxing and Muay Thai, and other practitioners add their individualized little bits of flair, I suppose. But I guess My experience of the sport has been that I did martial arts as a kid, found my way back into jiu-jitsu because I just loved the strategies and cadences of that sport so much. And then was like, wait, if I were to do cage fighting instead of jiu-jitsu, then people would pay me to do this and all I have to do is get punched in the face. So I don't think I was a person who was drawn to the sport because of its violence. I was like, well, you know, there's so many things about this that I love that I'll take the violence along with it. And then along the way, I think I learned a lot of lessons from that violence.
And are there a lot of women in the sport, let alone Asian American women?
That question makes me feel very old, or maybe my answer to that question is going to make me feel very old. Because when I started this sport, there were not a lot of women in the sport. There were no women in the UFC. And it was like really, really, really hard to find matches. I think especially because some women came to the sport without having really been an athlete before, and they were at the beginning of learning what it looks like to kind of master the composure that I think is shared amongst most competitive sports. And I had actually been a competitive runner in college and was like, I just need to not run in circles anymore. I'm completely done with that. But I want a way to use this fitness and this competitive drive in an arena that's a lot more fun. And people were like, we do not want anything to do with that. So it kind of took a little while. I felt the sport grew up all around me. And there was one time when I was like, I'm so strong and everyone else is just beginning. And by the time I retired, I was like, oh my gosh, I'm surrounded by these incredible athletes. And I'm now the old lady who loves tricky jiu-jitsu and can sometimes get away with it, which was lovely, but also meant that it was high time to retire from that sport.
So shifting gears a little bit, there can be some pretty rigid gender roles in traditional Chinese culture around what's expected of women and how they behave. How did your immigrant father relate to or not relate to your involvement in MMA?
Oh, if I had known you were going to ask that, I would read the poem where my father keeps telling me not to embarrass him.
You can read that right now if you want to.
I mean, I think that's the punchline at this point. You know, I think it's a really, my father has a really complicated relationship to martial arts, I think. He's like here in the audience probably being like, I could answer that question way better than this. But my impression was that his practice of Kung Fu was always his way of connecting to his early life in China, or maybe to his idea of China once his family had immigrated to Taiwan. So for him, it was a way of sort of like looking into the past. And there was he had this intense dissatisfaction that there was like not a Kung Fu school in town, because I grew up in rural Idaho, so obviously there was not. But there actually did happen to be a jiu-jitsu academy in town. So I think jiu-jitsu was already a kind of sad proxy for Kung Fu in his mind. And jiu-jitsu is like very different, and maybe to the outside observer, much uglier sport than Kung Fu. And so I think part of it had to do with that already. Like, why have you gotten so into this less aesthetic sport and one without the sort of cultural ties to our family's history? And the rest becomes a little bit difficult to entangle. I did not understand it the whole time I was fighting, but I understand it now that I have kids, right? My parents refused to watch. I don't think they've ever seen a cage fight live. And I'd go to the fights and everyone's whole family would be there. And mine was always conspicuously absent. And everyone's like, where is your family? Like, who is supporting you? Like, aren't they proud of you? And I was like, I guess. I think they would think they're prouder of my PhD, or would be happier if my nose wasn't broken right now. Or like, I don't know. So I think that has always very much been a tension. No, I think they were both athletes in their younger days. I think they admire the restraint and the way of, you know, the amount of facing down your fears that competitive sports require. But I think they were like, why this sport out of all the sports in the world?
So just to push on that a little bit, yeah, around the sort of gender roles, like I know in my family, I'm Taiwanese American. There was really kind of like the expectation that I'd be very ladylike and go to college, become very educated. But the like pinnacle of like feminine sort of accomplishment for my family is like when I became a mother, and nothing else mattered basically. So I am kind of curious about, you know, you're extremely accomplished, and you know, I'm just kind of curious about, were there certain gender roles around what being a woman, what is, you know, feminine, what that looked like for you and your family of origin?
Oh yeah, thank you for that. This is probably going to sound like a Chinese stereotype, but they were like, you will play an instrument beautifully, get straight A's, and also do a sport. And I did not play an instrument beautifully. Like, I think my family was very sad that I owned a violin. I did not get straight A's, but I fell in love with sports. So I think there was a sense of, this is not exactly what we had envisioned, but we don't want to hear that violin anymore. And we don't know what to do about your grades, which were not great, but not terrible. Just the kind of thing that we try not to talk about. And I remember my dad being like really, really proud when I got fast on the track, especially the miles. Like, I don't know, some like, you know, abstract, but quantitative, acculturative standard where it was like, you did this American thing, you ran the mile, and you did it in 4 minutes and 55 seconds. I can tell my friends, right? Like, that's something that translates. And then like he would check in, like, what's your time now? Oh, like 5:02, I can't tell my friends, right? Like, and so I think there was like that dimension where like, maybe I'm not very ladylike. I put on a dress today. That was a big accomplishment. I could not decide what pants and shirts matched each other. But in general, I think my family long ago kind of gave up on the ladylike components of this. I think maybe through some like maybe familiar battles. I think, you know, we'd go back to Taiwan, and I'm the oldest child in my generation. I'm also not a very tidy person, and my family's expectation was that I would tidy for everyone. Hence the don't embarrass me, that amongst other things, right? But it's not even that, partly I didn't want to, but also I don't really know how. I don't know how to clean up after an entire family. I can hardly, my husband, he's got a mask on, so I can't see his like full range of facial expressions, but I think he's like, that is correct. You do not know how to tidy after a family, right? And so I think at some point my parents were like, well, you're doing sports and we want to be behind it in the abstract, even though it's not the version of femininity that we imagine. But also, please tell us afterwards when you're alive. Yeah.
Well, let's shift gears. How did motherhood change your relationship to fighting and writing?
For me, motherhood changed like absolutely everything. And I think I was prepared for the most physical dimensions of that change, right? Like I had watched other athletes go through that, and I'd watched them come back from that. And some of them, some of my heroes in many sports, like, came back from having children to be like better athletes than ever. And part of that makes sense to me because, pregnancy and childbirth was by far and away like the most difficult like physical ordeals like of my life. I'm an impatient person, and so that made it like way worse, because this is not 15 minutes in the cage. It's like 9 months of unending everything two times, right? And I was like, oh my God, like, get me out of here. I'll take 15 minutes of anything over this, you know? So I thought I'd be ready to get back to the cage. But what I wasn't prepared for was the way that like my internalized sense of risk changed so dramatically. At a pragmatic sense too, like, I've got two of you I have to carry around now, and I can't break my arm. So there was like that part of it for sure. But I think I just got very much more concerned with like, like the joy in feeling like I used to like putting myself into that, you know, just that arena, and the way that the physical risk upped the stakes. And then I started feeling, as perhaps like, you know, people who are more
attached, more aware of their attachments to their kin feel before having kids. I don't know. Suddenly I was like, oh, we all have bodies, and I'm really stressed out about anyone's body getting hurt. And it's no longer a novelty for me to like step into the ring and like gamble on whether or not I'm gonna be hurt. So yeah, it wasn't just that. Like, I used to like riding my motorcycle, then all of a sudden I was scared of my motorcycle. I haven't ridden a single time since having kids, both because I'm like, I don't, statistically speaking, I don't want to die on that thing, but I'm also, I think I'm just afraid of it as well. And that wouldn't have crossed my mind before kids. In terms of writing, I think it changed. Again, like everything, the most practical thing was that I don't have the ability to open my computer because they type all over it and there's like, you know, 500 Z's in a row or whatever, and it's not a poem. And that really frustrated me for a while. And then I started just recording things into a voice recorder, and it really actually changed my understanding of what a poem is. And in a way, I think maybe brought me back towards maybe like, it's just like, yeah, what is this poem? Like, what were the sort of impulses behind, like, you know, I guess I've been really drawn to these sort of, especially like Tang Dynasty, like Chinese poems about like, oh, you know, sort of like having to take these journeys away from home and the sort of like visceral longing for home, right? And having the composition of these poems, like, you know, having the poems be built around breath and walking around my house and carrying humans and stuff, you know, I think that was really different from what I had experienced before, just looking at the blank page and being like, I have an idea, let me make it perfect. So yeah, it has both been a huge, children have both been a huge impediment to writing, but I think they've taught me a lot about how to write.
How to be flexible in your writing practice and evolve it, sounds like.
Yes.
So, you know, as an athlete, you were extremely disciplined and practiced in your sport. How did that sense of discipline shift focus when you turned towards writing?
Yeah, I think that has been a hard one because that's been a hard transition to make. I think because fighting is all, or any sport is all about like routine training, right? You wake up and you're like, I don't want to do this. I really, really don't want to do this. And then you get out of bed and you do it anyways. And that's, you know, just it ends up working. You're consistent. You do a little bit every day. And then one day you look at yourself and you're just like shocked by how much has changed and what you can do now. Writing for me has never worked like that. Like, I can wake up for like months in a row with nothing to write, and then I'll wake up one day and be like, I dreamed 15 poems, so I'm just gonna have to like call in sick and it's poem time, right? So I think like that has been sort of like big change. Like, I think I have had this sense of I really liked the hard work and the pride in these daily rituals, and writing has never occupied. I know for some writers swear by those things. That has never worked for me. So I think I've had to look for other rituals and try to, you know, save space for writing to be like what it is and not turn it into a daily practice. Because, well, I should say I tried that for a long time and all of the poems sucked. And then I had them and I didn't want to throw them away because I was like, but I worked so hard on them. But it wasn't that feeling of I worked so hard so they became awesome. It was like, I worked so hard and here they are.
Well, I think we can also talk about the breadth of your writing and reading practice, right? Because you also are an essayist, as I understand it, and write, you know, essays related to the environment. But you've also, I think, written about an interest or a practice of like memorizing poems. And so, I mean, how do those things inform your ongoing literary practice? You know, it's not just writing poems for you, right?
Oh, I think reading is one of those routines. I think I tried to calculate, like, before my children, especially when I was in graduate school, I was reading approximately, I don't know why I decided to do it. This is how my brain works. I was like, oh, what are all of these books on my shelves? How long did it take me to read them? I think I was reading about 1700 pages a week. And now it's probably down to like maybe like 500 pages. But that is like that is one of those rituals that can take the place of what training used to do, right? Just wake up every morning, read, lunchtime, like read, go to bed, read. And then the practice of memorizing poems, that's something that has always been really close to my heart, but maybe been in that more impulsive side of things, right? Like I've like discovered, I usually don't even realize that I've memorized them until like after the fact, something like reminds me and I will start. I think that I was at Breadloaf, so we saw Hyla Brooke. It's a poem that's in a Robert Frost poem. And I was like, this is the actual place where Robert Frost like wrote the poem about Hyla Brooke. And at the start of this experience, that was all that I remembered about Hyla Brooke. And then in the course of just a couple of hours of like, you know, milling around with like basically people just being like, yay, Robert Frost, here we are. I like called the sonnet back, I think it's a sonnet, almost entirely to mind. And I was like, I didn't even know that I knew this. And then I went and looked it up and there were maybe a few conjunctions off, but I was like, more or less, for some reason, I had that poem in my head all of these years and didn't even know it until today. And I think that's one of the really interesting things about our memories, right? Like people sometimes like ask, like, well, what are the literary influences of this book? Especially because the ones that show up overtly in the book seem so various and weird and not related to each other. Just like, that is probably correct. I don't think all of us are aware of our ghosts, you know, either our personal ghosts or our literary ghosts. And they kind of spring unbidden when we are least expecting them. And I guess I maybe like love the poems that kind of creep up on me like that. There's also a couple that I'm really proud to know by heart, but I'll spare you those at the moment.
Like which poems have you memorized or who by who?
This is like a question inviting like, you know, the sort of like the conflict at the heart of my scholarly existence, I think, because my PhD is like in Renaissance literature for the most part. I love George Herbert's poems. Like, what is this? Like all of these like, you know, like Renaissance religious poems. And I think I live very much in the now and I fight people and am agnostic. And I'm really interested in diasporic Asian literatures. So I have no idea why I love George Herbert or Thomas Wyatt or John Donne or Emily Dickinson, actually. Yeah, for some reason their poems remain, or maybe it's just like the cadences of their poems all remain seared into my mind. And every now and then I'll be in the grocery store, you know, just muttering to myself about religious violence while people like step away. And I'm like, oh, apparently it's John Donne Day at Safeway. So yeah.
So I want to make sure that we make space for audience questions as well. If folks have been filling out cards, if you want to pass them up in the audience and Stesha can collect them. And I also want to check in about the live stream to see if there are any questions coming in the chat. Particularly since Jenny's parents are online and possibly some of your students, if there are any
comments. My parents will be silent or they've become too anxious and have walked away.
Okay, and I see some questions being written, so maybe I'll ask you another question while people have a little bit more time. So your first book, you wrote Vesuvius at Home, when you were still involved with cage fighting, yet violence in your first collection seemed like mostly something that was being gestured towards versus being written about in the way that you do in Muscle Memory. So, you know, stylistically, these are really different books, and I'm curious to hear about what accounts for the shift in your voice or style or approach between these collections.
Yeah, thank you for that question. I think there's a couple components to my answer. One of them is that for me, at least, poetry seems like something that happens like in retrospect. And I've actually had the really odd experience of on Monday, Tuesday, just a couple of days ago, like I had an essay about competing in jiu-jitsu tournaments come out. And I just wrote that. I didn't even think it was fully done. And Kaya Press sent it to Lit Hub. And then they were like, good news, Jenny. And I was like, ah, like that, it felt like brand new, and I wasn't ready to like have it like, you know, separated and sent out in the world. But that I realized that in prose, I can write about the now. And I mean, aside from the whoa, that exists after a couple of months of work instead of like 10 years of work, right? I had the sense that that worked. And poetry has never really worked in that way. It's like you need some space to think about it. And that was when I wrote that book, I don't think it had even occurred to me to write about fighting. Like it was just like the blank page stayed blank. I think another one of the big journeys for me was, I think that I might have been the kind of Asian American who didn't realize that I was Asian for a really long time. And this wasn't really, it just wasn't on my radar as a set of concerns. I very self-conscious. I chose a college that was majority Asian. I think after growing up in a largely white rural town, mostly I think because I was like, I just want to like not think about race for a while. And then I didn't think about race for a while. And I think that the first book of poems that you're talking about, it came out right as it was starting to occur to me that I probably should think about those things, but I didn't have a language for it yet. It just felt like unapproachable and scary. And I didn't know how to grapple with that yet. And I think when you asked me about that collection to begin with, I was like, it scared me almost, I think, because I, in retrospect, that book almost seems like a first attempt at this book. And so I think it was an essential step for me. But now I look at it, I'm like, who was I and where was the other half of me in that book?
So we do have a couple of questions that came in from the audience. So one person wrote, they heard the reference of being like water in one of your poems, which is a reference to Bruce Lee and one of his kind of, you know, core philosophies. The question is, was Bruce Lee influential to your choice to being an MMA fighter or your transition into poetry? Because he was also very well-read and literate. And there's actually an amazing exhibition in Seattle at the Wing Loop right now about his book collection and just his writings and his philosophy.
You know, I think he has been one of my personal heroes. And oddly enough, I had never really discussed Bruce Lee with my dad until I was visiting my parents probably a couple of years ago now. And my dad and I just wanted to watch a movie, and somehow we decided we were going to watch Enter the Dragon, which I don't know if all of you have watched that, but it's Bruce Lee, like the sort of one of the famous scenes from that movie is Bruce Lee just looking like incredibly ripped, doing this like awesome kung fu in this like house of mirrors, and it's like every martial artist like dream of who we want to be, you know. And we get to that part of the movie, and my dad looks at me like with this just like super disappointed look on his face, and he's just sort of like, you know, I thought I remembered him being more handsome. He's not actually very handsome, like, is he? Right? And I'm like, what? And then I realized that this actually makes me feel like much better about all of the ways that I have apparently disappointed my parents and their expectations, because apparently Bruce Lee would have disappointed them too.
I'm totally excited that Ang Lee is going to make a movie about Bruce Lee, starring his son.
I know. I'm excited for that too.
Okay, so this is a more personal question, but it kind of piggybacks on part of your answer just now. How have you stayed true to your values and interests, even when receiving judgment from those you love?
Oh, those who love me are probably very annoyed by the way that judgment rolls off of me. I say that it stresses me out, and somehow that diffuses the stress, and so then I apologize and do it anyways. I'm perhaps compulsively true to myself. Apologies to all of you.
I'm going to interpret this question as being one that I think when you're a writer of the diaspora, it's something that comes up, but the question is, where is home for you? And I would add to that, like, what does home mean to you? Where is it? you know, as a diasporic person, as a mixed race Asian, you know, woman, like, where do you locate home?
I don't know the answer to that question, but I have spent a lot of time complaining about not knowing the answer to that question. I think for a very long time, I would have said that home was Moscow, Idaho. It's where I grew up when I was three until I graduated from high school and then moved to California. And then the entire time that I was going to school, I just dreamed of getting back to Idaho, like just growing up like in that wilderness and all of those mountains. And, you know, like my best friend's family would always take me like backpacking. And then when I got older, I would just explore the Selway Crags alone. And that was just like that was my place, you know. And after I finished my PhD, I moved back to Idaho, even though it was kind of like, where am I going to work? I don't know. Like, they don't really need Renaissance scholars in the wilderness, you know. I ended up getting a job teaching English at Northwest Indian College, which was actually kind of a dream job because on the way out to all of the places that I loved, working with the Nez Perce tribe, who is doing just so much like indigenous ecology and restoration work and stuff that was really close to my heart. But at this, even though I was like, this is the dream, right? It was not the Idaho that I remembered. I guess maybe because like being as a child, maybe you're sheltered from some of the forms of like racial violence and discrimination. But that place that I had built up in my mind, I was like, I don't think I feel safe here at all. And I remember like I was going to go backpacking alone, and I was driving out to the trailhead, and a big old truck just started like tailgating me, and then they hoisted the Confederate flag, and I was just like, I'm like, oh my God, I'm not going backpacking anymore, you know. And I know my parents have grappled with this as well, and it's just, you know, even in a place where we used to feel comfortable being alone, I think we no longer feel comfortable. So that has felt less and less like home, and maybe nowhere else has replaced it. And we were actually just talking on the way here, like Tacoma has started to feel like home, I think, in a way that even Idaho never did after all of those years of coming back to it. These are like my Tacoma. my friends and colleagues and neighbors. So yes, thank you for making Tacoma feel like home after all of the other homes were suddenly filled with Confederate flags.
Let's check in with Stesha and live stream Nathan. Okay. All right. Got a couple more questions for you. And if people still have any lingering things, feel free to fill out more question cards. But so going back to some of the themes in your work, women and mothers are pretty significant themes in your current book. And kind of toggling between your two books. In Vesuvius at Home, your first collection, the reader encounters a dying, dead grandmother, a mother who exists within a domestic space and identity. And in Muscle Memory, you really step forward as a strong female voice, an additional model of what women are or can be. And finally, there's the sort of journey of your becoming a mother as well. How do the depictions of women in your earlier work inform your own voice and identity?
Yeah, I think maybe I'm a little embarrassed by how limited those depictions in that early book were. Maybe this is just like something that somehow, it seems like a very Chinese thing to say, but I think it runs down both sides of my family, our difficulty in sort of praising people or, you know, commenting on people's strength when we encounter it. But certainly like the women on both sides of my family are like, you know, strong-willed and stubborn and very capable in their own ways. But I think all of us have some shortfalls, and maybe the shortfalls that I feel that I have inherited, I'm particularly critical of, right? We learn certain ways of being in the world, like from our mothers and our grandmothers. And so I think when I wish that I had learned different ways, you know, I used to look at them and be like, where did I get this from? And so I think maybe what has changed between these
books is also kind of discovering that I had found ways to talk about some of the, various kinds of strength that I suppose I've inherited matrilineally. I don't know why I decided to say that word when I was being recorded, but there's some of the strength that I've inherited from the women in my family as well. How's that?
I've got two other questions for you that are really about the process of putting together your book. So Muscle Memory is your first full-length collection of poems, and you worked on it for 10 years. You talked about the process of working with an intern at Kaya who helped to kind of sequence it. Tell me about the process of putting together this collection, and what was it like for you to work with an Asian American owned publishing house and with Asian American editors?
Oh, yes. Working with Kaya Press was a revelation to me. And I think I used to think that fighting and writing went hand in hand, and that I was someone who was really obsessed with technique and with finding exactly the right way to do something, practicing it a million times and making it absolutely just sort of perfect. And, you know, everything is just kind of like, you know, just like whittled down absolutely as much as it could possibly be. The poem about, like, you know, my grandma's cremation and this idea that, like, in on Taiwan, that, right, they're like, my family was there. I don't know, they had this vision that they were still in rural China and that they should have these like elaborate agrarian wedding, and not what, that's the wrong word, I don't know where wedding comes, elaborate agrarian funerals that would involve like extensive periods of time and a whole bunch of space and all of their like friends and neighbors like walking over to like interact with them. And then it was just sort of like, but you live in an apartment in Taipei and no one is getting buried in your apartment's courtyard. And where are the ashes going to go? And feeling like that wasn't enough space, and all of our family's bodies were having to be made so small, right? And how can this idea of like making a body like so small, how can that be a gesture of love when what everyone actually wants is this sort of nostalgic golden age space to let your body sprawl, even in death, right? So I think that is kind of something that has its place in the poetry world as well, right? I think one of the sort of like very, I guess I would now say, sort of hegemonically white understandings of poetry is like this idea of like crystalline poetry, in which you've made it to the sort of ultimate condensation of everything that thought could possibly be. And when I started working with Kaya, I think one of the things that that my editor helped me to do was, she just said, look, like these are like perfect MFA poems. Like they're tidy and there's no mistakes that anyone is going to like call you out about. It's like you've made every poem exactly the way a poem is supposed to be. But is that what you want each of these poems to be? And what life could they have if you let them be messy and you let them be wild and you let them sprawl on the page? And that is part of why this took so long, is because I was like, well, that's a nice abstract question, but I can't do those things. And I would try to do it for a single poem and then I'd be like, I hate it. And then I would put it back again. And it actually took a few years. And this actually coincided with the pandemic, which slowed down the whole publishing process. And I think actually gave me time to process all of this, which, you know, I think that was a happy coincidence in the end. Because I think I learned how to let the poems breathe a little bit in a way that they never would have breathed. And I think that I actually at some point really genuinely internalized that, because I was recently like in a poetry workshop where someone said something about another Asian American writer's poem taking up too much space, and I was like, look, like just instinctively just like, look, let me tell you a few things about like Asian poetry and space on the page, right? So apparently that's the new me, and I guess I like that better at the moment.
So the conversation about messy poems is interesting to me, because I personally, when I'm putting together a book, I love the process of sequencing things together, because that's where you see like the messiness in some ways tidy up a little bit in the arc across themes and the categories and being able to kind of shape and build and sequence a collection. And it's really super interesting to me that to a degree you kind of gave up that control, but I'm really curious about, you know, what you might have learned from that process and, you know, carrying into perhaps writing the next book. I don't know if you'll take that intern with you who helped to support that process. So, you know, talk to me a little bit about that part of putting together the book.
Okay. I have never been able to sequence this book. And I think it is because these stories are braided together, right? There's the fighting poems. There's these poems about gardening with my dad, I think because gardening and martial arts were two of the ways that we were able to connect. We actually fight a lot about a lot of other things. So I'm a rebellious, not traditional Chinese daughter. And I don't know, we have some clashes. So those are like two of the ways that we're able to find common ground and two of the ways that, two of the only ways that I feel like I can explore that part of my family's history. I'm not actually fluent in Mandarin. I can say a few embarrassing things and then my whole family corrects me 100 times and then I like give up. So having these sort of physical these physical languages of gardening, of fighting has been, I think, really essential. But I did not know which of these should be the exterior story. And then, you know, once just what happened in my life was I married John and we had kids, right? Then it became like, well, that's part of the story too. And is this going to be a story that is the arc of the story going to be about like my family's history? Is it going to be like a story arc about fighting? Is it going to be a story about sort of like, you know, growing up and growing into and then out of the sport and becoming a mother? Which of these is going to be the one that frames the book? And I could not decide. And actually my friend Vernon sitting up there sequenced this whole book earlier in the process as well. I tried to do it and I knew it was wrong. And then I sent an early version to Kaya. Like, we don't know, maybe. Vernon helped me resequence the book. And then Kaya said, yes, but resequence it. And then I was just kind of like, oh my God, like I obviously don't know how to sequence this book. So I was like really ready to give up control. The intern, Abby, when she sequenced the book, there were a few little things that I thought or things where I was like, oh, that's no longer chronologically accurate anymore. And it took a little persuading for people to no one cares. Like, that's not part of it. But I was like tied to the biographical truth of the book, right? But once I got over those things, I was like, oh, she got this exactly right. And because this was, you know, like still like, you know, at the height of the pandemic, I hadn't met her in person, but in my mind, I was like, she saw into my soul. We're going to be exactly the same, you know? And so then we met her. I was like, you sequenced my book. Let me buy you a drink. And she's like, I don't drink beer. And I was like, let me buy you a coffee. She was like, I don't drink coffee. And I was like, what do you drink? And it was just sort of like nothing that alters my state of mind. I don't like being altered. So, you know, this is like, and I just sort of like, oh, because I'm just like kind of a mess all of the time. And I'm like, bring on the beer, bring on the coffee. Like, okay, like we're ready to talk, right? And she was just sort of like, no. And I discovered that was actually maybe what this book like needed, right? Because I went from everything is all like buckled down to being like, everything is so wild and there's five stories in here at once. And I think at that point, maybe I had lost control of my ability to sequence the book. And I think the wildness helped the book, but it was like really great to then have someone come back in with that kind of like very like just logical linear mindset and say like, okay, so now that we have all of this, what order is going to allow each of your poems to kind of keep that wildness while having the whole book make sense as a story? So, yeah.
Well, I think we have some comments or questions that came in on the live stream.
We do. We have a couple questions. Mark wants to know who your favorite MMA fighter is. It's hard to choose just one.
I don't even know how to answer that. I don't know how to answer that at all. This is going to sound like a really weird reason why not to. I can't watch MMA anymore. I don't think I've watched an MMA fight since I retired. I almost don't even know the people doing it aside from my friends who I still have in the sport. Because then I want to unretire, and I obviously can't unretire because I can't. I don't train anymore. I can't weigh 115 pounds anymore. I'm almost 40 years old and my children would be like, where'd you go, right? So I think I've just almost completely just had to like remove that from my life. I don't think I have a favorite fighter right now.
Okay. Well, that actually ties into Hannah's question, which was, do you ever see yourself going back to fighting, even if it's just as a trainer or teaching your children?
Oh, I still train jiu-jitsu and I love it. It's been kind of messed up by, working so hard to get this book out, especially because so many people have worked so hard on this book. And every time I see them, I'm like, I will buy you a whiskey, I'll buy you some noodles. And this is the opposite of going to the gym, as perhaps you can all imagine. But nevertheless, like, you know, jiu-jitsu remains like one of the sort of constant things in my life. And I've started bringing the kids to the gym with me, so I get very little training in, but I love that they're growing up in the gym. And it's been great seeing them, start to grow into the sport. Although my son, he's 4, he had a hissy fit the other day and he tried to arm bar me. And I was like, apparently we're gonna like have to dial things back a little bit. Like, yeah.
We have another question, if that's okay. Anonymous asks, when and how did you come to poetry as a way to express yourself?
I have been obsessed with poetry since I was a pretty little kid. Speaking of like rebellion, my dad is a civil engineer and he is probably like into engineering, similarly to like how I'm into poetry or how I get so obsessed with the sort of historical and intellectual components of fighting, right? Like he early in my childhood bought me CD recordings of Walt Whitman reading his poems and having that recorded by a wax drum. And I think that his idea was that I would be so thrilled by the sense of like, even all those years ago, we could record the sound of a human voice because yay, technology, I'm getting my daughter to be an engineer, right? And that totally backfired because I instead was like, oh yeah, the wax drum, that's cool. What is this poetry, right? And so now I think Walt Whitman is not one of one of the poets I would place at, you know, the sort of center of the kind of poet I've become. But you know, I think his poems were certainly a part of my early imagination and sort of opened my eyes to that's, I guess, what just feels like a different dimension of the universe unfolding in the written word.
Hey, well, Jenny, thank you so much for coming and sharing your work with us tonight. She's going to be signing books if you want to pick up a copy of Muscle Memory at the table from Billy and Open Books. And thank you so much for coming out tonight and listening in.
And I'll jump in and say thanks to both Shin Yu and to Jenny for being here. And I wanted to let the online audience know that I've posted links to both Jenny's books and Shin Yu's books available at Open Books. So if you want to click in the link that are in the chat, you can find those there. And of course, you can find both of their books at the library, of course, as well. And our website address is spl.org. So for folks that are here with us, Jenny is going to be signing books at that white table there. And once you are heading out into the evening, I'll ask that you drop your surveys in a little basket here in the blue table. For folks watching online, I've posted a link to the survey in the chat. And we're so grateful to everybody who made tonight's program possible. Thanks to our program partners, Open Books. Hi, Billy. We love you so much. And thanks to our sponsors, the Gary and Connie Kunis Foundation, the Seattle Times, and the Seattle Public Library Foundation. And of course, thanks to all of you for joining us tonight. We will see you next time next year. So have a wonderful, happy new year.